All right, I just want to start off by saying thank you for inviting me to be here today and to share our story as an organization and our humble beginnings. Before I talk about the work that we do at Wine to Water and why we love getting to do what we do every day, I think it's important to know a little bit about my background, a little bit about my DNA and who I am, and it may help you to understand a little bit more on a deeper level of who we are as an organization and as a team. So I think it's important to know I grew up not too far from here. My family is kind of from the Greenville, South Carolina area, and then moved on up to Greensboro, North Carolina, is where I went to high school. But I grew up in one of those families where everybody around me was about as exceptional and perfect as they come. They don't make people more exceptional and about perfect as they did in my family, minus myself. I was the one exception to that rule. I've got a family full of athletes. I always wanted to follow in my granddaddy's footsteps. I wanted to be a football player. He played professional football for the Pittsburgh Steelers back in the late 40s, and that was what I wanted to be just like him. He was who I was named after, so that's what I wanted to be. And I realized a few years into my football career that probably was not going to happen, because in order to make it to the Steelers or even just college ball one day, my rear end would eventually have to leave the bench at some point. And that didn't really happen a whole lot. So I decided maybe football is not going to how I impress my family with my athletic ability. So I started playing basketball, thinking, all right, I was pretty what I thought competitive, athletic with basketball, started doing good, so I thought, until my younger brother, by 5 years younger, he turned out to be 6'9". And then I really realized what it was like for somebody to be gifted in basketball when my 11-year-old brother started dunking on me in the backyard. So I realized basketball was not where I was going to really impress my family. And so I switched. I had one more shot with sports. My family's a bit of a golfing family. My granddaddy taught me and my cousin how to play golf, so he would take us to tournaments on the weekends and to the driving range. And on these tournaments, I saw my cousin's name at the top of the leaderboard every tournament, right there at the top or one or two off the top. And my name was always one or two right off the very bottom of the leaderboard. And my cousin, of course, went on to play. He's on the PGA Tour right now. He's playing this weekend in the PGA Tour. He's like top 10 right now. He won the U.S. Open a few years ago. I never made it to the tour. So I realized sports wasn't where it was going to be for me. I'm not going to impress my family with my athletic abilities. So I switched now. Another way you can kind of impress my family is with your scholastic abilities, your academic abilities. That was worse than sports for me. I'm one of those, I don't know, I grew up, in the 80s and 90s when I was in school, and they didn't have all the ADDs and the ADHDs and all that, but if they did, I would have had all of them. I'm one of those kids, I just can't sit still. I got too much to do outside those windows. There's just so much of a world out there, and every time my teacher sat me in a desk and made me just stare up for hours at the front of a room at a chalkboard, I could not make myself focus. I remember, no joke, in my fourth grade year, I remember my teacher literally duct taped me to my chair because I just kept getting up and walking out of the room. I'm pretty sure like she might go to jail these days if that happened. But I was one of those kids, school didn't make sense to me. I didn't understand and learn the same way maybe a lot of you learn, or my sister. My sister was top of the class. I was there when she made her first and only B in her entire scholastic career. I was there that day, and she literally wept tears because she had a B. I would also cry if there was a B on my report card. Totally different reason, though, because I just never saw a lot of those. I was a straight C, D, and other letters below that student. So, you know, I realized school wasn't going to work for me. Sports, obviously not. So I got one more shot to try to impress my family. One more shot. And that was more like on a spiritual level. My daddy was a preacher man when I was growing up. So it's like, gosh, if you can't be good in sports or in school, if you can just be good at being good, then you're going to make it all right in this family. And that was worse than the other two for me. Unfortunately, what I thought that whole world meant, and I've come to think differently now, but when I was younger, what I thought that whole world meant was that I just had to learn how to follow a lot of rules and regulations. That's all it was. Go to church on Sunday, sit down, stand up, do this, don't do that, a lot of don't do's. And so I got to the point where I got to be 18, 19 years old, and I measured myself by all the things that I didn't do well. That's how I measured myself. So honestly, I got to the point where I tried college out for a few months, didn't really last out on my first go-around, and I dropped out. Just went as far and as fast away from the Carolinas as I could get. I have some family out in Montana. I just needed to get away and kind of clear my head. And I had this vision. I had this old, I don't know, y'all may be too young to remember, they used to have these old Marlboro Man billboard commercials. Like, that's who I wanted to be. I wanted to be the Marlboro Man, go be on a ranch out in Montana and never be heard from again. And so I actually got a job on a ranch out there, and I'd worked with horses some during my life, so I got a job on the ranch working with horses. And this vision I thought in my head is that I'd be riding the range every day. You know, kind of like the old Western movies, too. Maybe I'd get in a gunfight or two, you know, like the OK Corral, that kind of stuff. And that is not at all anything. The movies do not paint a clear picture at all of what it's like working on a ranch. I'd say 90%+ of my time, I was shoveling horse manure all day long or cleaning stalls. That's just what I did. And the other little percent of my time, I may get to ride, but it was a very small percent of that time. And I didn't make good money. I had to live in the barn for about 6 months just to make ends meet. But something very important happened to me during that time. I remember being out there, and I'd go weeks without hardly seeing anybody. I was alone for most of the time. I spent my first Christmas out there alone by myself. And I remember something very important happened is that I feel like the first, you know, maybe 19 years of my life, there was just this voice in my head that constantly screamed at me just how I wasn't good enough, how I wasn't like everybody else. And I think that was the first time in my life that voice just kind of went away. There wasn't anybody for me to measure up or down to. There wasn't anybody for me to look at and say, oh, gosh, well, I'm not going to be able to do that. I was by myself. And something really strange started happening where, you know, I felt like that voice that was always there saying, you're not like everybody else. You know, you're not good enough. You're not whatever. It's not that it went away completely, but I feel like it almost, I heard something different for the first time. Like, for the first time, I felt like I heard something saying, you're not like everybody else. But maybe that's okay. Maybe it's not a bad thing. Maybe it's not a negative. So I heard something else, too. That was my mama's voice screaming at me on the phone. I didn't have a cell phone, so it was one of those long corded phones that we had in the barn. She was trying to get me to come back home and just, you know, y'all probably know how mamas have a way with their boys. So I finally came back home and tried to struggle my way through a degree. I started back in community college, tried to get my grades up, and finally made it back to where I transferred over to NC State for the last bit of my college time. But I found another job while I was trying to work my way through school, and I started working in the restaurants, started just serving people food, waiting tables. And I fell in love with that job. I loved that just being a server, if I did my job right, if I brought the food out hot with a good smile and a good conversation, I actually had the ability to have a positive impact on these people's day, on this family's day. And I got paid for it. And a lot better than even being on the horse ranch. So I was like, this is a really cool job. I enjoy it. And something started to happen as I'm going my way through school. I worked my way up, and I got the promotion of all promotions, which in the restaurant bar world, it's to be a bartender, not to be a manager. Nobody wants to be managers. But I got to go from being a server to being a bartender, and I thought that I had, like, arrived at life. Like, this is the epitome of life for a guy. I mean, there's lots of fun stuff going on, like, every night. There's live music. The money was way better even than when I was serving, which was way better than it was in the barn. But none of those reasons are why I fell in love with my job as a bartender. I remember when it all just kind of clicked with me, why I'm like, I don't think I ever want to do anything with my life but be a bartender. Was I could sit at my bar. The last place I worked at was this old Irish pub in Raleigh, North Carolina. I sat at the bar, and I remember looking out and seeing all walks of life that were different from me. There might be a CEO of some big company sitting over here with his white collar, sitting next to a school teacher, next to a construction worker, next to a stay-at-home mama. And nobody was at that bar to measure up or down to each other. Everybody was there just to just take a deep breath, maybe forget about their day, have a good conversation, talk about something on TV, I don't know, but there wasn't any of this judgment thing happening that I got so used to as a younger person. And it was one of the first communities, I think, that I ever really felt like I could just be myself. I could just be me. If I wasn't having a bad day, I didn't have to pretend like I was. I just was myself. I remember my favorite thing about the bar is that people would do the same thing for me. If they were celebrating something awesome, they just got a promotion. They're getting ready to get married. They're going to do their bachelor or bachelorette party or whatever. They'd come and celebrate with me. They just had a baby. They'd come and celebrate with me. Or something not good. Maybe their lives are falling apart. Maybe they just lost their job. Maybe they just lost a loved one. Maybe their marriage is falling apart. They would come and share that with me. And that's why I fell in love with my job being a bartender. So why am I here today? Why am I not back at the bar, the old Irish pub in Raleigh? I don't really know. I don't really have a good answer for that question. I think I stopped looking for answers a long time ago. But I remember when it all started to change for me. This was December of 2003. And I'm one of those people, you could probably tell by just a little bit of my story, I make a lot of mistakes. But unfortunately, I'm not the kind of guy that can just make a few mistakes and kind of string them out over a period of time. When I make my mistakes, I make them all at once. So it's like a massive train wreck. Like the wheels are coming off the train. I'm sliding sideways into the station, taking out the station when I'm trying to stop. So it was one of those train wreck times of my life. And I'm like, I went to my boss and I'm like, it's Christmas time, you know, of 03. I'm like, I need a couple weeks just to kind of get away for a little while and gather my thoughts. And my boss was like, take as much time as you need. And I had Christmas off of school at that time. So I went home, Little Mountain community, a little bit further from here up north in Boone. I'm sure y'all know of our little area up there. My parents had just kind of retired up there. And I just went to get away from everything for a couple weeks. And in the middle of the night, in my bed one night, I'm tossing and turning. I couldn't sleep. And I had that phrase in my head over and over. It was like a broken record, wine to water, wine to water. I couldn't get it out. I don't know why it was there. I remember I keep a pad and pen near my bed. I like to write music. I play a little bit of music, so I thought maybe it's a cool idea for like a country song or something. It's backwards. My daddy told me lots of stories, obviously, in the Bible growing up, but the water to wine story was one of my favorite ones. But why is it in my head backwards? So why? Maybe I can make something cool out of it. So I started writing it down. But right when I could see the words just like that written on the page, I just kind of got this, like, I don't know, this nervous feeling in my gut. And I just knew it was supposed to be something else. I didn't know what. I hadn't really paid any attention to what's going on in the world. Didn't know at all that there was a water crisis in the world. Had no clue. But I couldn't sleep that night. So I went down to my parents' computer and I just started researching. I dealt with wine every day at my job, so I'm like, I'm not going to look up anything about wine. Maybe I need to know something about water. I don't know. So I just started Googling that night about water, and that's the night I learned about there's people in this world. There's young children and mothers and families that are walking hours every single day, hours upon hours, to get something that we have coming out of our tap in like 2 seconds. And not only that, when they get that water, it looks more, you know, like this when they get it. And obviously, as I began to research that night, I found out that it's dirty water that, and diarrheal disease because of dirty water that's claiming the lives of more children than anything else in the world, than anything else. And I just couldn't believe it. I couldn't wrap my head around that. And so I remember that night, I couldn't sleep. I took that pad and that pen, and instead of writing down some idea for some cheesy country song, I ended up writing down the concept for this organization that we got. And as you heard earlier, it wasn't to be where we are now. I didn't know we were going to ever reach 1 million people. I didn't know if we'd ever reach 1,000 people. I didn't know we were going to make it to where we can work in 40, 50 different countries around the world. I had no idea. But I remember those first few days, I'm like, maybe I could just do one thing right with my life, just one. So I remember It took me about 6 weeks. I took that name there, and I'm like, I got to do something. Maybe I can get people to come to my bar. Maybe we can host an event. Maybe we can raise a little bit of money, and maybe I can help, like, one of these families not have to walk for 5 hours that day. Maybe those kids will get to go to school now, or they won't be home sick because of the water they're drinking. Maybe that mama can spend more time with her kids, or maybe she can go in the field and be more productive or make crafts and make more money. I have no idea. But maybe I can help one family, just one. So I held an event. Again, it took me about 6 weeks to pull it together. We had about 300 people show up. I didn't have any clue if it was even going to work. And they came. We raised like $5,000 or $6,000 that same night. Another restaurant owner came up to me. He's like, "Doc, this wine to water thing was really awesome. Can we do this at my bar across town?" And I'm like, "Well, sure. I guess I hadn't thought about doing another one, but we can do another one." So we held another one. Another few $1,000s comes in. Opened a P.O. box, a bank account. People started learning in the service industry what we were doing. Just started sending in checks or donating their tips. So next thing I know, I'm sitting on a bank account, literally growing with like tens of thousands of dollars in it. And I've got no clue in the world, no clue how to do this work here. No idea. I first started thinking, gosh, maybe I just take the money and donate it to an already established organization. You know, why reinvent the wheel? I don't know how to dig wells. I've never even been to one of these countries before. So that was what I was going to do. I vetted a lot of organizations, found one, again, based out of Boone, a group called Samaritan's Purse, a great organization. I've done a lot of research on them, found out the type of work that they did, and they had great water programs. So I just went to talk to somebody and interview somebody and say, what happens if I give this money to you? Where does it go? How do I know it's going to make it to clean drinking water and not something else? And so I got a meeting with the head of their international operations, and he was very generous with his time and allowed me to ask a lot of questions. He answered those questions. And at the end, I'm like, all right, this is awesome. So I'm just, every month or two, I'm just going to come bring you guys a check and just make sure it goes to that right there, and I guess we're good. And he stopped me, and he's like, "Can I ask you a question?" I'm like, "Well, yes, sir." He's like, "Why are you doing this work? You want this to be your job?" I'm like, "Well, no, sir, I got a job. My job's great. I don't know why I'm doing this." I don't even know if I honestly had a good answer for him. But I remember I was like, "Well, let me just tell you what happened this one night, and I'll tell you why I can't stop doing this now, because I've got something now in me that's, you know, for the first time in my life, I'm a part of something that's actually not a failure." So I told him about the night and what happened and why I just can't get it out of my head. And he kind of smiled and he said, I tell you what, I got another idea for you. Instead of going back to your bar and just hosting another event, you'll have plenty of time to do that. But for you to be able to tell people about what's happening in the world, you need to see it for yourself. You need to come see it. So how about you go back to your bar and you put in your notice, and why don't you come work for me? I'll send you anywhere in the world. You know, we have programs that you'd like to work out with water. And then when you're ready, when you feel like it's time to come back and start your own thing with wine and water, I think you've got something here that'll work. And I remember I almost fell out of my chair. I said, "Well, yes, sir, that would be amazing." And 6 months later, I was on a plane to this place here. That's in Sudan in the Darfur region. I'm not going to get in to all my time there. The year of my life that I spent in Darfur, it would be hard to cram all those things into just one talk up here. But I'll tell you a couple things. One, I don't think I've ever felt so much shame in my life than those first 2 weeks on the ground there in Sudan. And the reason why is because in the weeks leading up to my trip, I remember I did all this research on the people of Sudan and the area I was going in Darfur, and I'm finding out it's a 95% tribal, black African Islamic community, 95% Islamic. And here I am, you know, for y'all can tell by the way I talk, I grew up around here. My daddy was a Southern Baptist preacher growing up, so I'm a Southern white Christian kid from the South here, transplanting to tribal black African Islamic community. I don't think there's anything more opposite on the planet for a guy like me. And I remember I had family saying, why are you going there? Why did you pick that place? Why? that you don't understand these people is what they would say. You don't understand. Why would you do this? And I remember, unfortunately, I started to believe some of the things that I was reading and being told. Kind of like that old lie that I used to believe about myself, like it started to creep back into my head, but instead it was towards somebody else now. And I remember I got there, my first 2 weeks, started to meet my team that I began to build. And I've never been more ashamed in my entire life. Because these are some of the most hardworking, honest, loving people that I've ever met in my life, ever. Welcome me in their home. I'd go to a village and meet somebody that had literally nothing, like maybe a chicken left. And that person would gladly have given me that chicken so that we could share a meal together. And that would be all they had. Some of the most generous, loving people I'd ever met in my life. So it took me a while to kind of realize, like, gosh, there's so much about my worldview that I have to change now. And I've only been here for 2 weeks. I remember we began doing our work around the desert. I didn't have a lot of money to do brand new wells. Sometimes it's $10,000, $15,000, sometimes more to dig a well. And I did some more research, found out that over 60% of the wells put out throughout this region in Africa, all of sub-Saharan Africa, over 60% are sitting there broken, not being used. So we started to pull together a team, get some tools and materials. We'd go around and pull the guts up out of these wells and find out there's still water down there, but some little small piece in the pump just stopped working. A little rubber seal had been corroded or had disappeared or whatever, or a pipe had rusted a hole in it. So this well that was sitting there, this one here, you can barely make out the concrete ring that was around it. That one, I think, was sitting there for about 5 years, not being used. We pulled it out. And literally, once we got the pieces out, it probably took us 15 minutes to fix it and maybe $50 in parts, maybe. But these people now were walking hours because they didn't know how to fix this well. So we started fixing hundreds of wells, and I realized, well, wait a minute. Maybe the problem's not that just these wells are broken. Maybe the problem is nobody's ever taught these people in these villages where we're going, never gave them ownership, never taught them how to fix their own well, how to fix their own problem. So I started thinking about it a little differently. Instead of us going to fix people's wells for them, what if we were to form like a little water committee in each village and teach them, train them, educate them on how to fix their own problems? Wouldn't that make more sense? So for me, that's when it changed everything. My whole perspective of what charity work should be is I realized it's not just going around and giving stuff away for free, but that it's going around and empowering the local people where we're working so that they're doing this work. So I'll go back to this first picture after Darfur. Actually, I'll tell you one more story there in Sudan. I was getting excited to now come home and do this in other places. The first picture that you saw, I'll go back and show you, was in Cambodia, where we began to grow. And I wanted to take that idea of empowering local people around the world. Before I left Sudan, though, made it a little difficult because one of the groups that we were working with is a group that lived. They were about 3 or 4 hours away from where our main compound was with all our supplies and materials. And in between, to get there, there was the group of I guess you'd call them the bad guys. It was the militia that the government was giving money and weapons to eradicate the people of Darfur. I had to go through their territory, and they were a nomadic tribe, so they had horses and camels all throughout the desert. And I only seen them once before because they wander very far. And the first time I saw them, it wasn't good. They pulled my guys out of the vehicles and lined everybody up on their knees with their hands behind their back. They smashed some of the guys with their weapons and their guns, and they allowed us to leave and said, if we ever run into you again, we're not letting you leave next time. And in this one area, not too long later, there was a cholera outbreak, so we decided, me and my team, which, by the way, I made the team, I don't know why, but it kind of happened this way. I guess I kind of wanted to see what would happen. But my team guys were like half Christian and half Muslim because I just wanted to see how they'd work together. And they did amazing, by the way. And I told them, you don't have to come with me. After what happened last time, I'm going to go. But believe me, if you want to stay here because you have families or whatever, I get it. I wasn't married at the time, no kids. And all of them, minus one, the guy on the right in the black shirt, all of them minus him came, and he would have come. He was just couldn't get out of the bed. He had malaria, so he couldn't come. But they were all willing to do whatever it took to risk their lives to do this work, no matter what background they came from, no matter how they prayed or didn't pray. And so we went, made it through the area, got to the village we were trying to help, were able to work there, and on the way back, we saw that there were some horses and camels up on the hill, and I got closer to this village. Last time I saw them, they jumped in the road, and they shot their gun off, and they stopped us. And this time, they weren't nobody in the road. And I kept seeing guys on either side of the road as I was getting closer, and I'm driving the lead vehicle, and I'm like, what do I do? Do I just keep going? Do I stop and try to talk to them? You know, I'm just asking these questions in my head, and I'm getting closer and closer, and I couldn't decide. Like, it was one of those things where I just kind of froze. And then a few seconds later, I felt my foot hit the gas, and I'm like, all right, we're going to go. That's what we're going to do. So my foot made the decision for me. So, but like the second my foot hit the gas, I had my window down, and there was a guy I caught out of the corner of my eye, like at the last second. He had his machine gun right on me. And right when I hit the gas, I could feel like the blast from his barrel. The other guys on the other side of the road started shooting. I remember what it sounded like there. Not just the gunfire, but when the bullets would like hit the truck, when it would hit the metal or smash through the glass, and I got the guys behind me, my team on the truck behind me, screaming on the radio in Arabic. I'm doing my best to learn to speak their language, and so they're like, "Digiga, digiga, we need to stop, we need to stop." And I'm like, "La la, humps to the guy, like no, like 5 minutes, man, you got 5 minutes," because they had their tire shot out. They're trying to tell me they had their tire shot out, and I didn't have time to tell them, look. A lot of the folks that I work with had kind of learned to drive recently in the last few years. I'm like, look, I've been driving since long before it was legal, and most of it off-road in four-wheel drive vehicles, and I'm here to tell you that tire is going to, you're going to make it on the rim. You're going to make it. But I didn't have time to tell all that, so I just was screaming at him in Arabic, like, la, la, khamsa the guy, 5 minutes, man, 5 minutes. You can make it 5 minutes. So my thought was, if we can make it 5 minutes on the rim out of this ambush, by the time they try to chase us down on their horses and their camels, we should have that tire fixed and on our way. And so we made it about 5 minutes down the road. We had that tire changed like the most well-oiled NASCAR pit crew that you've ever seen. We had it like 90 seconds flipped off. We were on the way again, didn't see them behind us, not even a trace of them. Got back later that night, and I'm kind of inspecting the vehicles. I looked at my vehicle. I had gas tank. Had been shot out. I had two on that Land Cruiser, so thank goodness I had already before switched to the other one so it didn't just run out of gas. Checking the other vehicle out, and as I'm done checking the truck, I came back and looked at my vehicle one more time, and I saw a bullet hole that had come right through the back window of my Land Cruiser, and it looked like a really good shot, like to hit me right in the head. So I'm looking at it. I'm like, man, that's really spot on. So I opened the back door, and I'm looking, there's no hole in the seat, and there's no hole in the dash in the windshield. And I see that I have a cardboard box right behind my seat that I keep there that holds chlorine tablets so we can treat the water supply. That bullet had come in the back window, and I could see the straight line on the top of that box where it was headed right for where my head was in the seat. But I didn't see a hole in the seat. I didn't have one in my head, nothing in the dash. And I just kept looking. I got closer on that box, and at the very edge of that cardboard box, I could see where that line of that bullet was in a straight line, and then right before it got to my seat, that bullet did almost 90-degree turn and just went that way. And I'm sitting there thinking, I'm like, none of that makes sense. I've also grown up kind of hunting and stuff and shooting, and bullets kind of, they just tend to travel straight. You know, that's just kind of how they do. That's what they like to do. And I remember looking now at this new line and putting my finger on it, and sure enough, right down, I could see a little hole in the edge of the vehicle. I stuck my head out the window, and you see this big, massive bulge of metal where that bullet had gone in, right headed for my seat, took a turn, slammed into the side of the vehicle. And, you know, to be honest with you, my heart was racing still. My adrenaline was up. I didn't have time, I don't think, to ponder the mysteries of the universe that day. So I was just kind of like, that is crazy. And I just kind of went on about my way. But I think about that day now. And I don't know why, you know, like I told you, I don't have any answers. I stopped, I think, trying to have all the answers a long time ago. I don't know why I'm here. I got no clue. But I don't think it was an accident why I woke up in the middle of the night that night. I don't think why that bullet didn't hit me in the head. I don't think it was an accident. I don't think anything in this life is just happenstance or accidents. And I think about that day. I'm glad that I get to be here and get to do this work. I'm glad that not long after coming home, I got to meet my wife. And I have to be honest with you, when I came home, I was pretty defeated. I was going to probably just throw my hands up and go back to being a bartender, because not long after that ambush, even though we kept working, the bad guys there, they're, in the local language, they call them the Janjaweed, which means the evil horsemen. They ended up capturing one of my guys on my team, and they executed him. So the few days before coming home, instead of celebrating like we were all supposed to be celebrating the handover of the programs to our team, we were having a funeral for my friend that was killed, who left behind a wife and kids. And so I came home, and again, like I said, had I not met my wife, I would have just given up. And I met her back here in a bar, of course, because when I came home, I just wanted to hear some good old classic rock. So they had this like Lynyrd Skynyrd cover band playing, and I was there being kind of emo. I'm in the corner not wanting to talk to anybody. And I remember the doors of this place, they were on the far end of it, like double doors. They like swung open and light shone in from the street, right? And this whole pack of really hot girls like walked into the bar together, a whole pack of them, you know. And I've been in the desert for a year, so I was like, holy moly. But then I remember bartenders, we kind of have these unspoken rules, like if you're there alone, you should never go hit on a girl in a pack of girls, because they will tear you limb from limb. I've seen it 100 times at the end of the night. So I'm watching, I'm like, holy moly. And then I went right back to being that really weird guy by himself in the corner, not talking to anybody. But a little bit later, I get a tap on my shoulder. I turn around, and I'm not kidding y'all. You can go look on my Facebook page if you want. The smokingest, hottest girl in the entire group, the smokingest, hottest one I've ever seen in my entire life, had come up to me, stuck her hand out, smiled, and just said, hey, my name's Amber. What's your name? And I'm like, lower the voice. You got this, man. You got this. Stick your hand out. Introduce yourself. I'm like, Amber, it's nice to meet you. My name's Doc. She's like, oh, Doc. Okay, cool. So you're a doctor. And I'm like, yes. No, not a doctor. But everybody calls me Doc. Nice to meet you. And I'm trying to move things on. So by this time, she's sitting there. She's like, your mom had you, looked at you, and said, I think I'm going to name him Doc. And now she's kind of like tapping her foot. Like, what's your name? And I'm like, okay, it's not my real name, but this is not a good story. I was trying to move on. I want her to think that I'm like some cool cowboy kind of whatever, Doc Holliday, and that is not the case. But I knew by looking at her, I wasn't going to get away with it, with not telling her. So she's like, how'd you get the name? I'm like, all right, well, I'm named after my granddaddy, the football player. His name is Dixon. But unfortunately, when I was born, my sister, who was 2 years older, the really smart one, yeah, well, she wasn't really smart when she was two. And so she couldn't call me Dixon by my real name, so she called me Dick Doc, all right? So unfortunately, a lot of my family actually, till to this day, refer to me as Dick Doc, and they think it's really funny, and that's great and all. And I tried to cut the first part off and leave the Doc part, you know, make it a little cooler. And now by this time, she's laughing hysterically at me to my face, which I thought it was a bad sign, but now that we've been married for, I don't know, 15 years or so now, I've realized her favorite thing in life is to make fun of me. So it couldn't have been a more perfect way for us to meet. But I'll tell y'all, the most beautiful thing about her had nothing to do with what I could see on the outside. I learned very quickly that my wife, she has this way about her on those days where I don't think I can do this. I don't want to get out of bed that morning and do this anymore. On the days where I'm my worst enemy, I turn back into that person a lot of times that looks in the mirror and that doesn't like what they see. And it's times like that that she's there to encourage me and help me along the way. And because of her encouragement and confidence that she helped me to find, we were able to keep growing. And the work that we began to do around the world became much more than just about wells. As I was telling you before, this is the very first country after Sudan we went to. We built this drilling machine made out of all local parts from a local tractor. They were digging wells for like thousands of dollars, 5,000 plus, I think, in Cambodia. The water table is not as deep as Africa, but it's still expensive. Well, we got our cost of our wells down to below $500 because we're using local people, local materials to do the work. From there, we realized, you know, it's not just wells that people need. People need clean water. Even if you are going, there's plenty of places that they live right along the river, and they've got access to water right there. But like I said, it looks more like this. So we need something that can clean it. So we started working in Uganda with these biosand filters. And we can use all local people, local materials to do the work. $100, and we can make one, and it lasts for 10 years. For 10 years. For $100. For up to 100 students in a school can be on one of these things. So we started getting into filtration. Again, the whole idea was local people, local materials. And then from there, we got into a new style of technology, a ceramic filter made out of clay. That's my oldest son there that comes with me a lot of times and helps do this work. We were able to make these clay ceramic filters, and for $50, we give a family a filter that when they get it, it's so much fun to see them take it home and how they cherish that thing, because now this father knows that we show him all the data and the metrics, what happens, how much less money he's going to have to spend on medicine for his children now, how many more days of school they're going to be able to be a part of and not miss because they're not homesick, how many work days that he is not going to have to miss now from him being homesick. We show them these numbers. We're really big into data and metrics. And you see them when they get these filters, they just cherish them. It changes their whole life. We got to a point, though, from there, which leads me to what y'all are going to be a part of this week. Another war disaster happened that started kind of pulling at my heartstrings, and that's when the war broke out in Syria. I found out there were 1,500 families living on the Turkey-Syria border after the war got really bad. Turkey had closed their borders and sent no more people. Y'all probably remember the images coming out in the news at that time. A lot of unfortunate things happening with the refugees trying their best to flee, whether it's in the Mediterranean or whatever, and a lot of them, especially a lot of children, not making it. And I remember I couldn't get those pictures out of my head. And I found out about these 1,500 families that are sitting along the border that were drinking water that looks like what I keep showing you. And we had to do something, so I couldn't bring these filters, the big ones that you see on the screen, the ceramic ones, they're too fragile. Put 1,500 of them on an airplane somehow, they're going to break. I don't know how we're going to get them to them. Or the biosand filters, they're even bigger and heavier. I can't put that many on an airplane and get them over there. So what are we going to do? So I was able to get a meeting with a company called Sawyer that makes these filters predominantly for backpackers and hikers. You can put it on the top of a water bottle like this, or we can attach it to a bucket like you see, similar to the one that's in this picture there, but like you see behind me. And I found out these are ceramic filters clean water to what's called log 4, which is beyond our EPA standards. It's 99.99% clean water. These clean to log 7, which is 99.99999% clean water. And they're this big, less than the size of a Coke can. They last for 10 years, but I couldn't afford 1,500 of them. If you go to REI or a sports store, you get them for a hiking trip, they're expensive. So I got a meeting with the CEO of the company, told him what I wanted to do with them. He's an awesome guy. He said, I tell you what, I'm going to basically get you these filters for our cost, which is a lot lower than what you pay for them in the store. We have a lot of other components, though, that you're going to need to have that make it attached to a bucket because they want to have them in their home, pour water in a bucket. So we're going to get you all those, but everything's going to come down broken into like 14 or 15 pieces, and you're just going to have to build that back at your office. And I'm like, that's fine. That's a huge help. So by the time we got the filter, all the components together, the cost of the bucket, the cost to fly them over to Syria, the cost to form a team to teach the people how to use their filter. And again, we're really big on not just dropping something and leaving. So the cost to have that team follow up, do data and metrics, is your filter working? All that wrapped into the cost of one filter is about $50 for all of that. So I'm like, all right, how am I going to get 50 times 15? What's that, like 75 grand? So I remember I was on a stage like this. It was like some type of corporate event. They wanted me to come share the story of Wine to Water and how we got started, so I did. And there was like 500 people in the room. And at the end of the talk, somebody just raised their hand. It's like, I just got a question. I'm like, all right, shoot. I'm like, what do you need right now? Like today? What's your biggest need? And I'm like, well, there's 1,500 families stuck on the border of Turkey that are Syrian refugees that are drinking not good water. I'm trying to get them water filters. And I don't have the money. They're like, well, how much is a filter? So I told them it's about $50 a filter. They're like, all right, thanks. And I'm like, okay, great. So I was there at this event with my wife. So when it was over, I went over to the corner and we were drinking coffee and I noticed these people were all chit-chatting and talking and I didn't think anything of it. But then about 30 minutes or so later, somebody walks up to me with this big manila envelope packed full of money. They'd walked around this event, just started gathering money from people, and I opened it and I was like, oh my gosh, it kind of freaked me out. I hadn't seen all that much cash in one place before ever. So I looked at it. My wife and I went to they took us to a back room because it was a lot of money. And we counted it, and it was, to the dollar, it was $75,000 in that thing. This big old envelope, some checks, things like that. And I was on a plane like 3 days later. This is the border of Turkey and Syria. I had to kind of sneak in. Wasn't really, I guess, the most legal thing to travel into Syria at the time. So, again, I'm not really big on rules and regulations anyway, but... So I was able to sneak in. We got all those families' filters. We partnered with a Islamic charity that I had worked with a little bit in Haiti. They had used our ceramic filters in Haiti, so we already had a good relationship. So we partnered with them. The name of their charity is called Zakat, which in Arabic is like their word for like giving or for charity. So we partnered with them, and we were able to have a massive impact. And then from there, more disasters started happening, like the Philippines, the super typhoon. Y'all remember that went through Tacloban? I mean, it was a disaster. I got flown into Tacloban like the right after it happened with a C-130, and this is what it looked like. And we brought thousands of filters with us to hand out to the people so that when it was time for the kids to go back to school, their water was looking like that. We gave them the filter, and that's what it would do. And the same thing happened. I was somewhere... They were asking, what do you need? Or I can't. I was on the phone maybe with a company, and they're like, what do you need? I told them, I'm trying to get filters to the Philippines. And they asked how much. I told them we were going to do, I think the first group was like 1,000 filters. She's like, we're going to cover that for you, but we got another question. We've heard that the filters, you need to actually put them together. And instead of y'all doing that in your office before you fly them over, can our team, our staff, can they put them together for you? So can we sponsor them? Can we buy them? And can we put them together for you? And so I was like, you're going to pay for them, and I'm not going to have to be at the office till 3 in the morning putting these filters together with our team. I'm like, yes, 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 you can do all that. That's awesome. Thank you so much. So that's where our filter program was born. It wasn't a bunch of us sitting in an office like, hey, how can we do something to raise a bunch of money and have a fun team building? It was like literally out of necessity. That's why I love our organization. Everybody on our team, they'll tell you the same thing that I don't think any one of them would have thought 5-10 years ago they'd be doing what they're doing right now. All of us, we kind of view ourselves as some of the most regular, normal, everyday people that you'll ever meet. But we've all agreed that if we can just put one foot in front of the other, maybe try to listen, not to that voice that's in your head that's lying, that's telling you things that aren't true, that you're not good enough, you don't have anything to offer, just not listen to that. But there's something else in there that can guide those steps, that will lead you down that path. And we do that together as a team. And because of that, now this filter program has far expanded up the reaches of the Amazon jungle that you see here, where we can fill one of these dugout canoes with hundreds of filters and bring them to a village. And I'll leave you with this this last picture here. Hold on, let's see if I can find it. This was taken in one of the refugee camps there in Syria. And I always like to end a picture, end a talk with something like this, because, you know, most people, when they hear about the work that we do and the places I've been to some of the most war-torn, not-so-good places that the world has seen in the last decade or more. And a lot of people think, gosh, when you get there, the people must just be devastated. They must just be just, the Syria, you see the images on the news of these kids, a bomb is just blown off and they're dusty and bloody, and they must just be miserable. And I see pictures like that, like you see on the news or like an organization uses with the kids with their flies on their face. I see that less than 1% of the time, less than 1%. When I go to these hard areas, war-torn areas, this is what I see everywhere. I remember something that actually just popped in my head that my daddy would say, that it's the poor, the meager, the weak, they're the ones that are going to inherit the earth. And when I see this picture, of course they are. Of course they are. So when I think about this work, a lot of people kind of pat us on the back. Y'all been able to help these people and do all this and teach them all these things, and that's not what's happening here. These people have given me and taught me infinitely more about life than I could ever, ever give or teach them. The gift they give me and our team is infinitely greater than just this water filter that we're able to give them. And I just want to say thank you for being a part now of our team and our family and taking part in this filter bid that we're going to do in a few days. I'm super excited to get to know y'all more, hopefully here in the coming days and weeks and months. Y'all, thank you for having me. Can y'all hear me through this thing? Sweet. I figure I keep it on. When there's stage empty by myself, nobody around, it's one thing, but somebody else. I want to do a demonstration just to show you. I guess I got to take my mask off to drink it, because I got to drink it. But just to give you an idea.
Quite a bit different. Our teams in the field, they drink this water. The families, my family, were in the field. We drink the same water, whether it's from here, whether it's from the ceramic filter. So, y'all, cheers. Thank you for having us.
All right. Excellent. Oh, man. As noted earlier, my name is Lane Perry. I have the privilege of working at Western Carolina University, and now I have the privilege of sharing a stage for a brief period for some Q&A with Doc Hendley. I teach a class called Social Entrepreneurship, and I spend a lot of time talking about the idea of calling and the hero's journey and, you know, these sort of concepts. And if you've never heard of that before, it doesn't matter, because you've literally lived the sort of hero's journey that's been codified by this guy named Joseph Campbell. And it's just something that I continually try to relay to students as a lesson. But I think today, getting to see what a person who has pursued an external calling because they were internally tuned enough to hear it, right? That feeling you had in the gut, the moment when you woke up and you had wine to water in your head echoing, that's just such a powerful thing to be able to witness in person. And to be able to hear you tell the story on stage that is so much bigger than you, but it was better because of you. It's just a really powerful moment for all of us to have gotten to share this morning in person. So I'm very appreciative of your time and your energy over the last 15 to 20 years, Doc. So thank you for being with us this morning. This is not part of the show here. It's just an important moment for me to reflect on. I want to move into some Q&A. So let's hear if there are any questions from our live audience today who might want to stand up from where you are and maybe step forward and come to the front of the stage right here, and you can offer your question from there. Who would like to be first? And if you need a couple of seconds to reflect, you can. I've got a couple of questions I'd like to ask, but I want to give you all the first right to do that.
No questions off limits. It could be about my boots, anything. So it doesn't have to be like the typical, you know, something chemically related to the filter or whatever. So.
Yes, please.
I'm gonna come up here so I can hear you.
Can I write an article on you for the Imagine magazine?
It's sure.
A cool magazine. I thought that it's something I'd like to put in because it also relates to the campus theme water. So.
Great question. So here's the question was, can you do an article on Doc and Wine to Water for the Imagine magazine? So let's follow up on that and to put you on the spot if you're comfortable.
Well, make sure you get my email and then we can, if you want to ask questions or whatever, we'll get it squared away.
And if you had to think right now and you were doing an interview with Doc, what would be one of your first questions you'd ask him in that story? Yeah, that would be a really great first question. Sort of some of the content that you've provided a little bit of information on has been really sort of in that space. So extending off of that and using that as a springboard question, what I often tell my students, the world is not at a lack of great ideas. It's at a lack of great follow through. And so for me, I'm really interested in what you see the key ingredients to taking a good idea to having great impact. What do you see as some of those ingredients if you had to identify them?
That's a really great question. Because I've had people tell me, like, you know, I've had experiences like that in the middle of the night, and I've just felt like I should do this or should do that, and I didn't for whatever reason. What's the difference? And so I don't really have the best answer for that, but I think I have an idea. I think it's less about me. And it's important for y'all to hear this because I think sometimes we put people on pedestals like, gosh, I can never do what that person does or whatever. Well, that was me most of my life and still is sometimes. I look at another founder of another charity who their charity's grown 10 times faster than ours and they've already reached 50 million people and we're only at 1 million. And I'm like, gosh, I'm never gonna, you know. So I think we always kind of have that default, that negative thing in our head. So one, you got to put that aside. You got to put blinders on. Stop worrying about what everybody else is doing. Stop worrying about how fast they're moving or slow they're moving, and you move at your own pace. But two, one thing I tell people is that, you know, out of all this team and everything that we've done, sometimes I feel like I'm the weakest piece. Maybe, arguably, maybe the most important, because, like, if you think about a wildfire generally is started by a small spark, something small. And then it grows into something much bigger and beyond even the ability to control. So you've got to be in a perfect surrounding for that to happen. It need to be the right conditions for that to happen. So for me, the only way any of our programs, we've had a lot of successful programs. We've had a lot of programs that have not been successful, that have failed. And generally, it's not necessarily because the idea was right or wrong, but the circumstances surrounding that idea. And for me, what has made successful programs is if I can spark an idea or a thought and then have people that are strong in areas where I'm weak around me to then execute those things together as a team. So for me, when I see people do, they have these ideas and then they feel like the weight of the world's on their shoulders. I've got to do this. So they'll try to do this one event. They'll try to do this all on their own.
And generally, even though the spark may be the most important in the beginning, a small spark is, a lot of times, is a weaker part of the overall fire. So you've got to make sure you have people around you that catch that vision and catch that fire, because there's going to be days like with me that I didn't want to do this anymore. I felt like a failure. And I had my wife there to keep that fire going, you know. So for me, that's a big thing. It's not just having the idea, but surrounding yourself with people that when you're weak, on the days that you don't feel like you can do this anymore, you've got somebody picking you up, dragging you in, because the next week you may be doing that to them, you know.
That's a great answer. There's this really interesting, very brief TED Talk that talks about how to start a movement, and it's the lone nut dancing guy. And the lone nut, right, the person out there dancing like a wild person, is but a lone nut until the first follower comes. And so much is on the lone nut that then turns into a leader to accept the first follower and to include them and to show them what they see the future looking like, and then to tap into the skills of that new follower. And it just perpetuates. The next thing you know, you see this mass movement in this video. If you haven't seen it yet, it's quite a bit of a metaphor for what you just described. And I think that's having a strong team. That's awesome. We're getting questions pouring in right now, so now I've got to kind of do my job and try and figure out what the question might be that's next. So from Morgan Owen online, she says, do you have a team that travels with you, or do you connect with people on site to build a new team each trip?
Okay, that's a great question. Generally, I travel alone when I'm doing this work. In the early days, it was very different because I was with another organization. I didn't know what I was doing. So I had a team on the ground that welcomed me, that began to teach me the ropes, how to do this work, how to kind of talk their language, to go to United Nations meetings, things like that. But then as Wine to Water began to grow, I mostly do, when I'm traveling, go to the places alone by myself. And then just like she said, I think you said her name is Morgan, begin to build a team there, that they're going to be the people on the ground that are going to be like, I'll be in Tanzania like in 2 weeks. So we have Wine to Water East Africa, which is based in Tanzania. And it's a team of all local Kenyans and Tanzanians that are there locally. And they're the ones that, you know, are going to understand the culture and the language and the people. So my job is to go there and really just continue to encourage and be that spark and empower them to do that work that they do much better than I could ever do. And same in Nepal, same in the Amazon jungle, same in Dominican Republic and Haiti. So generally it's that. But we have a huge team of Wine to Water staff and workers that do this work, that still travel also. We have a great international team. So I'm actually traveling less these days than the rest of our international team that does this on a regular basis. So.
And a follow-up to that was, what's the next trip that Wine to Water has planned currently? Is there one on the radar?
Yeah, so I'll be in Tanzania myself in a few weeks, working with our programs there. We're digging some wells right now. Tanzania is one of the few countries that's allowing Americans to travel right now. So I'm like, sweet, I'm going. So I'll be there. I'll probably be with my family in Dominican. We have a water filter factory down there, probably over the holidays. I'm figuring there's probably going to be like a second wave of COVID. And so I think I want to head to where it's warm. I hear vitamin D is really good. So we'll probably go work with our team in Dominican. But as all this stuff kind of like hopefully fizzles out, we find a cure, or, you know, we get a vaccine or whatever it is that happens. We do love to have people travel and work alongside our teams and to volunteer with our teams, whether it's the Amazon jungle, Nepal. My wife's been to Nepal numerous times. We have a great, very strong women's program there. She just loves going and serving alongside young women and mothers there in Nepal. Tanzania, another spot. Dominican. So if y'all, as things we start to be able to travel more, please keep us in mind. We love having volunteers come and work alongside our teams over in the field. So.
And that's something we're actually working on with Wine to Water and Whitney right now, in trying to figure out a way of scheduling or organizing a trip once we can get those back up and running from the university side. Once COVID, we figure that out a little bit more clearly, of course. This one's a little bit more personal, and it comes from online as well. We'll come to a live studio audience here in a second. So someone out there be ready to rock and roll. But right now we're going to listen to Brooklyn Lester. How does seeing the people's expression after you help them affect you? What are your first thoughts right after you help them?
That's a great question. Gosh. It's very humbling, I think. Because to me, it's so simple. There's so many problems in this world that are very complex, that are very difficult to understand, whether you're trying to create a behavior change in a community to reduce the rate of HIV/AIDS or you know, any number of other political or socioeconomic problems out there. But this right here, it's simple. So I'm always kind of torn. Like, I remember my first project I ever did where the people in this one refugee camp were walking hours, like between 4 and 5 hours through the Saharan desert to get water every day. And we got them a little water system hooked up, clean water pumping, so that it was like 4 or 5 minutes. And the entire community rallied around me and my guys and our truck and our team. And they all, the local language there, it's mixed between Arabic and the four tribe language. So their word for water, which is a little different than Arabic word is, but is Moya. And they were just saying, Moya, Moya. They were chanting over and over, like in like thousands. There was over 10,000 people in this refugee camp. And they were all surrounding us. And it's a strange feeling because it's exciting. It's like, oh my gosh, they only have to walk 4 or 5 minutes. The kids can go to school. The moms can be productive. But I also at the same time have this kind of check in my spirit too, like, this is not hard. I'm not a rocket scientist. I'm not an engineer. There's so many more people. Why can't we solve this problem? And we can. It's one of the easier problems to solve if we all kind of came together to do it. So also, while I'm having like this exciting experience, like, this is super cool, in the back of my head, I'm like, gosh, there's so much more to do. And it's not hard. This is not difficult work. It's not ending wars and dealing with political or religious tension. It's literally just giving people water. So I'm always kind of, I guess, a little torn, like, very exciting, very humbling, but also like, man, if we all got together, this could be finished. I said in the beginning of this that my dream is to one day to work myself out of business. If I can go back to being a bartender because all the world's water crisis is solved, then great. I'll go back to the pub. So
that sounds like a vision statement, to put yourself out of a job so that you can go back to bartending again. Wow. So we want to pivot here. Is there anyone from the live audience who wants to step up? Yes, please come up here to the front of the stage if you're comfortable. Please maintain distancing as you come up to the front.
I'm going
to
get up here because my ears aren't very good. Great question. I can do that. All right. So she asked about Cambodia. I don't know if people in the live audience can hear. I mean, and the ones watching. But she says she had a friend in Cambodia. What's kind of an impactful story from Cambodia? So we dug hundreds and hundreds of wells all throughout Cambodia, right on the Vietnam border region. There's a province down there that was one of the like most poor provinces in all of Cambodia. We put wells throughout the entire province. And I remember one story very vividly. I had gone and just put in a new well, and my team said, hey, we need to go check on another one. We haven't been back there in a while. We need to go just check and see how things are going, make sure the well's still working. So we went, and we got there, and it ended up being, we always write in the concrete the date that we put the well. So it ended up being like 5 years to the day or something crazy, like, we put in this well. And I see this lady and her children, and she's just like super like beaming with, you know, she's excited that we're there. And so through my staff member, you know, she's translating in English, and she's like, thank you so much for coming and for this well. You need to know what it was like before I had this well. She said, my husband is not in the picture, has been gone for years, so I have to raise these three children. And Every day would have to go into the village and beg for rice, beg for enough food for my family. It was very hard for me to do. And she said, after your team came and gave me and my family a well, the next time I went in, I was able to get some seeds. And we used the water now from this well. And I could see she had this beautiful garden. And she said, we grow our own food now. So now my kids aren't sick. We're drinking clean water. But now we have all this food. And I haven't had, in these 5 years since I've had this well, I haven't had to beg for food ever again. On top of that, there's other families that come to me now in the community because I have more than I need to provide. So when I learned early on that water does so much more than provide something to drink. It creates economic impact and benefits and a lot of other things as well. So anyway, I remember that story very, very vividly, but we're right, the province name is Spa Rain, and it's right along the Vietnam border where most of our operations have been. So,
I think your point about it being so much more than water, right? That was one of my preliminary questions was, how have you seen economies change in these communities? And we'll circle back to that because I want to give the students some airtime here. So we just have a comment from Emma Dixon. Emma says, I don't have a question. I just wanted to say thank you for speaking today. Your story really spoke to me because God clearly has a calling on your life. And I love that you chose to follow that. Thank you. That's what Emma Dixon wanted to articulate.
Awesome. Thank you, Emma. Thank you.
Okay, so now we're going to get into a more specific question here. And for the record, we've probably got about two or three more questions in us. So if anyone's really itching out there, I'll come to you all next. Okay, so this is from Kaylin Lewis. What are the mechanics of the filter used? How does it work? And you can reference the video that they're going to get exposed to this next week as well, if you need to.
Perfect. Yeah, so everybody that's going to be taking part in the filter build, you will get a video showing how to break it down and get it to where it can go onto a bucket like this. But basically, the concept behind it, the science behind it, is it's the same technology that they use in kidney dialysis. So in kidney dialysis, they use something called hollow fiber membrane technology, which basically means they force blood through these very small, they look like little teeny spaghetti noodles is what they look like. And they're small fibrous membranes where the water's forced through there, just using pressure, using gravity, and able to come out the other side. And that's able to clean that water, again, to log 7, which is beyond our EPA standards clean. So the technology came where the founder of the company said, hey, if we can clean blood with this technology, why can't we clean water with this technology? The most beautiful thing about this technology, though, is that there's other things like this out there. There's something where it's like a straw, and you can drink with it out of there. The reason why we don't use that is because these have the ability to be backflushed and cleaned using a syringe. So because of that, they will last for 10 years. The other ones, after a certain amount of uses, they get clogged up. Those little spaghetti noodle-looking things, they'll get clogged up with dirt and sediment, and you have to just throw them away. So as far as the only technology that we use that's not produced in country, we wanted it to last for a really long time. So 10 years we felt like was about as good as we can get. So,
yeah, that's excellent. It's excellent to hear how the technology works. And so please note, like Doc said, you're going to get a chance to look at one of these filters up close and personal over the next couple of weeks in your Honors Forum classes and in the Ripple Effect class. So get excited. I know I am. So let's go to a question from the audience if we have at least one more out there. All right, come up here again closer to the stage, but still maintain distancing.
All right, that's a great question. So I don't know if everybody heard that back home, but she asked, I'll try to shorten it down a little bit. She asked basically during those really hard times where things aren't going well or things are not going the way I had planned or whatever, what has kept me grounded and able to push through. So I'll start off with this. There's two things. Neither one of them have anything to do with me. And the only thing maybe that has something to do with me may be the fact that I think I've just gotten used to failure so much in my life. When I was younger, I failed a lot. So failure doesn't devastate me maybe as much. Some people, I'm just used to it. But the two main reasons why, one, I've already talked about, my family, the team that are around me, that's what, if we're having a hard day, they're the ones that are able to pull me along. But there's a lot of times I'm having a hard day and there's nobody around. You know, I'm in the middle of a desert somewhere. I'm in, you know, just come outside the Syria border and I'm just questioning so many things. And so for me, on a very deep personal level, you know, it is very much a faith-driven thing for me. It's very much, and again, like I said, my father and I have a great relationship now where I no longer, when I was younger, I felt like I couldn't ask hard questions. But now as I've gotten to have a good relationship with my father, I can ask hard questions, and we've got to a place where we may not have the answer, and that's okay. But my dad always told me that the one thing he asked, he's like, I'll worry if you stop asking questions one day, but if you never stop and you just seek, he would use that word all the time, just keep seeking, then one day what it is you're seeking for, which for him is something a lot bigger than we could ever imagine, he's like, you will find that thing that God wants to be seen. He wants to be known. He wants to be found. And so in those times where I don't know if I'm going to make it out of a war-torn area or a place or whatever, I remember very vividly, I throw my hands up. I'm like, if this is it, this is my time, this is my time. And because my life, I feel like, is so much deeper and more than just the tangible, there's something so much greater than it helps me to be okay with the unknown. Like, how much longer are we going to have to wear these things? I don't know. Are we all going to get it? I don't know. But I'm all right. You know, there's something so much more beautiful out there for all of us that excites me. So I guess that, for me personally, that's what keeps me going in those really difficult times. So thank you for that.
They say if you know your personal why, you can get through any what. If you understand the meaning and the purpose in your life, you can overcome any what or how. And I think that that's sort of what you're really speaking to. And that came from Viktor Frankl's Man's Search for Meaning, who had actually survived the concentration camps during the Holocaust. So powerful words from an informed person on stage currently and then also from the past. So we got a practical question here. What advice would you have for anyone who's looking to work in the nonprofit sector?
Okay, that's a great question. So a couple things is there's some people that are passionate about something here locally. There's so many needs here locally, which is awesome. And there's a whole other group, because it kind of changes the answer depending on what it is, that they want to be in another country. They want to see the world. They want to travel. And I feel like what I've seen a lot is that there's a lot of people that wait almost for permission to do something. Like, I want to be in the nonprofit sector, or I want to work on, I really want to be involved with feeding the homeless or a food pantry or digging wells in Africa or whatever. And I think that I would say you don't need permission to do those things. There's a lot of times we have this fear. Maybe you don't come from a family that, like, my family had not traveled to any of these places. What I try to encourage people is just start moving towards that thing. If it really is traveling and getting out there, start, once we are able to start traveling, sign up for the first trip that you can with the school and spend 2-3 weeks somewhere that you might make you a little uncomfortable, but just do something, like put that one foot in front of the other. I think sometimes people are planners and they try to plan every detail out. Like, I want to get this degree and then I want it to help me do this, and so I'm going to need to know how to do this, and all that stuff is great. We need planners in life, that we all do, but sometimes we lack just the ability, I'm just going to start moving. So, and you may not have all the degrees figured out and all what you need on paper, but generally in the nonprofit world, what they love more than anything is, what experience do you have? What have you done? So the second you can volunteer or intern or do whatever, the second you can get some type of experience and even just show up, there's so many places around the world. Like, you could be in Tanzania right now, and if you were in Arusha, which is where our headquarters is, there's a number of organizations that if somebody walked and knocked on the door and said, hey, I'm here to help, I'd love to stay here for 3 months and just serve with the organization free and clear if you help put me up or something. Like, so I want to encourage, you know, don't wait for permission. You don't need permission to get out in this world and make a difference and make a change, whether it's right here down the road, maybe in Nashville or Charlotte or Atlanta, or whether it's across the ocean. You don't need somebody to tell you it's okay. It's okay.
And I think it's so important to hear that from Doc, because if you recall, Doc was at this moment where he had this money that had been raised through his first initiatives through Wine to Water when it was starting, and he was working with Samaritan's Purse. And he's like, well, I really might need to get over there and see it for myself, right? So he shifted from potentially what could have been a life of, not in a negative way, but of armchair activism, Monday morning quarterbacking on what could have been and could have been. You went over there and you
exactly,
and you put yourself into that, and that's what we encourage students to do as well. Don't have opinions about food insecurity in Jackson County. Go down to the community table or work with Mana Food Bank and see what it's like to engage in that space to learn more about it. So, man, we have questions pouring in, but I know we're going to run out of time. So let's do it this way. We have time for two more questions, one from the audience and one from where I am right now. So who has the last question from the live studio audience? I know we've got some itchy feet out there. Yes, sir. Please come up towards the front of the stage, please.
All right, great question. So he asks, would one of the best things you can do as an individual would be to just continually to educate yourself on what the needs are out there? I think I've got that right. And I would say, yes, that's a big part of it. But I'll tell you, for me, I think that educating yourself and learning and knowing are they kind of got to go hand in hand with what I was saying before, like at moving at the same time. So the second you learn something that really like makes you feel this tug, this pull, man, that may be something that I really could be interested in or really would want to help with. Just don't wait, try it. And then a lot of times you don't know until those two come together, whether it's food insecurity in Gaston County, and you know what, I'm not okay with this. Sign up, go somewhere, you know, put the two together. Because for me, as y'all heard earlier, school was never my thing. You know, I didn't know how to study or I wasn't the best reader. My wife thinks I'm literally insane right now, though, because I'm like the most avid researcher like on the planet now. And now it's gone beyond just water. Now it's like it's current political climates in certain countries because it affects my work. Like I research like crazy. So for me, the cart kind of had to come before the horse. Like I didn't get excited about learning and studying in school until I started doing something. And now I'm like, gosh, if I'd studied something that was related to something I was passionate about in school, I probably would have had like a 4.0 GPA instead of a 0.04 GPA. I don't know, whatever. I'd say like the two really got to go hand in hand, because you can just study, but sometimes that gets mundane, and you know, so you got that passion really needs to go alongside of it. Great question, thanks.
Well, and there's dozens of comments in here that are just saying thank you messages, we'll make sure we share those with you after the fact, but it would probably take too much time here in person to read them all. So our last question coming in from our online viewers is, what has been your favorite place to visit and serve, and why?
Oh, man, that's a great question. It's so hard to choose a favorite because the cultures and the people are so beautiful and different in their own unique way. And that's really why I love a place, is because of the people and the culture. And they all have something so unique to give. So I would say on that level, there's pretty even playing field. So if I'm going to go back down, then you're looking at like just general, like, oh my gosh, in awe of like the beauty of a place and the food and like, and then the other aspects of a culture. So I'd probably say I'm torn between Tanzania, where I'll be in just a couple weeks, There's something just when you get into a country, and we love to say that we're not in a place just to see the hurt and the need. We do that, but we also love to take in the beauty of a country, of a place. And Tanzania is beautiful. I mean, the Serengeti is there, and Mount Kilimanjaro is there. You could see Mount Kilimanjaro on some days from behind the hill of where our factory is. But the second highest mountain, which is a volcano, Mount Meru, is right behind our factory. I mean, just this beautiful setting, you know, and taking a drive and seeing giraffes, and like, it's like you just stepped off a time machine a couple hundred years ago. And so Tanzania would probably be one of those. And the food, I just love eating, you know, different types of food between there. And then I think Nepal, too, is one of those places where it's just such a special people, but as well as place. I mean, our headquarters is in Kathmandu, so you're like right up on the Himalaya Mountains. You know, and Everest is like just a stone throw from where our office is. And then I ride motorcycles. It's like my passion, you know, other than work. So the team there will always get me like a little Royal Enfield old school motorcycle to rent while I'm there, and I'll ride down. Our programs are down near the India border. So you can like go tearing down the Himalayan mountains on a motorcycle, like, and I mean, literally like rock slides coming down. It is awesome. So Nepal is probably one of those places too.
Well, I don't want this to be lost on anyone. Doc has referenced numerous countries with the word factory and headquarters directly tied to those countries and communities. And you cannot take that approach to this work lightly. It would be so much easier logistically to leave one headquarters somewhere manufacturing everything and just distributing it around to the other communities. But the way you can impact those communities in the long term is by having the factory and the headquarters and the education and the empowerment at the local level. It provides jobs, it provides buy-in, all of the things you need for the programs like Wine to Water and bringing water to people who need it to be successful on a scalable level. That did not accidentally happen, and I assume it is extremely difficult working through different policies and government systems to build headquarters in Tanzania, in Arusha, or in Kathmandu, in that particular area, or in other Latin American countries where you all have headquarters and things. Like, that's, I don't want that to be lost on anyone, and I just want to really drive that point home, because it's been a clear part of you all's strategy as an organization, and I think it speaks volumes.
Oh, thank you.
And then the last thing I'll say, if you recall, and then I'll give you the last word, but if you recall, Doc made reference about what he loved about bartending and the people from the different lives sitting at his bar at night in a place of being able to serve them and listen to them and maybe not even offer any advice, but listening's enough at times. I think what's happened in the way you're talking about the world and your own calling and your mission of Wine to Water, you've turned the world into your bar. And you're working with different cultures and people from all over the world, up and down that bar. And you're working with them and you're engaging with them and you're changing their lives. And you know, beyond a shadow of a doubt, you're still so aware of how much it's shaping you as a person. And that's powerful. So I'm going to stop there for a second, because anyone who has class with me knows that I have a tendency to not ever stop. But Doc, did you have any final words or comments for us today before we wrap up?
Yeah, I'll just say one thing for everybody back home. I think that's the camera. I don't know if we got two on here, but I think that's the one. Everybody back home watching and everybody out here, that I think we've all got it. There's something within us, this voice that sometimes tries to keep you down, tries to put you down, that tries to make you look at yourself differently than you should. And I really want to encourage you, do not listen to that. It is a lie. There's so many things that it'll tell you that are just not true. You have so much worth and value to give your local community, the global community. So I'd say, once you learn to realize that is not true, when I look at myself in the mirror and the thing that I hear, it's not true. Once you can dismiss that, then you'll begin to hear that other voice that's so loving and encouraging and just desperately wanting to see you believe the truth. So find that voice. Don't listen to that loud one that's screaming at you that you're no good, because it's just not the truth.
That's awesome. Let's hear a round of applause for Doc here one more time. All right, I'm going to put Doc on the spot here, and I'm going to ask him to draw a number and then read that number out loud. And this is for a free copy of his book.
We got 34.
34. Who's lucky number 34? Hey-oh, nice one. And we'll get you the book, and then we'll get Doc to sign it after we're done up here. And you can come on up and grab it now, though, for sure. And then we'll get Doc to sign it. We've got a pen. So just stick around right afterwards. Thank you so much. That's awesome. Wait, let me see. It's 34. Okay. I believe you. I'm just kidding. Okay, I want to make one quick housekeeping note here. For those of you who are out on YouTube right now watching, we're having trouble with the QR code to demonstrate your presence this morning. So I'm going to give you a tiny URL. It's tinyurl.com/WCUcure. That's tinyurl.com/WCUcure, C-U-R-E. So thank you for listening to that little notification there. As we exit, we'll take pause here in a second, and we will perform our exit going sort of row by row. So we'll go with the first row, and we'll let them leave, and then 20 seconds later, the second row can leave. Is that okay with you all? So just hold on for a second here. I want to give one last opportunity to say thank you to Doc for your time this morning. Thank you for your mission being fulfilled. Thank you for listening to that deep, quiet, at the time voice in your head that has led you to go on and do inspirational things that have fundamentally changed the lives of people all over the world. So without further ado, one last applause, please. Thank you, Doc Hendley.